Muhammad wa ali Muhammad salawat. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali. Just have a few quick announcements. Tomorrow is Eid al-Fitr for the followers of marhum Ayatollah Khoi and other Maraji. Eid namaz will be held at 7:30 a.m. Surah Yasin, followed by Dua Nutba, 8:15 a.m. Eid namaz and khutbah by Sheikh Shabir Hassan Ali, ending with Ziyarat Warif Sam. Tomorrow night, Eid night for the followers of Ayatollah Sistani, the program will begin at 8 p.m. At 8 p.m. with Surah Yasin. Then there will be ladies Chandana Arat, as well as the gents Eid program, and which will end with Namaz al-Maghribain, followed by full Iftar Niyaz and the Amal for the night of Eid al-Fitr. Just a quick announcement. Our current website is currently down and not accessible. The live broadcast can still be accessible through the livestream.com website. Updates to the programs will be circulated through email, WhatsApp, and through the answer phone. Also, we have been selling the Cooking Without Barriers book, which is a cookbook made by the World Without Barriers charity. They are on sale for £5 each. All proceeds do go to the charity in feeding the hungry little children in Iraq. Bar Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad salawat. I would now like to invite Sheikh Mohammad Abbas Panju to do the short talk, and then followed by the Q&A session, which is open for all, for the gents and the ladies. The ladies can either pass the questions through the kitchen, or they can message the WhatsApp on the Jamaat WhatsApp number. Bar Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad salawat.
سورة المباركة الفاتحة أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله بارئ الخلائق الأجمعين باعث الأنبياء والمرسلين ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء حبيب قلوبنا وشفيع ذنوبنا أبي القاسم محمد اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد والصلاة والسلام على أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين لا سيما ولي الله الحجة ابن الحسن صاحب الأمر والزمان اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد روحي وأرواح العالمين له الفداء ولعنة الله على أعدائهم أجمعين من الأولين والآخرين إلى قيام يوم الدين أما بعد أحبائي before we begin with the Q&A session just a couple of points which are important to be made. Number one, continuing or as a completion from last night's majlis, over the last few days, we identified just about 9 different meanings of the word fitnah, or say 9 different ways in which the word fitnah is used within the Quran. And yesterday, the 9th meaning of fitnah, which we explained, was the camel of Nabi Saleh. And we read Surah Ash-Shams, and we outlined very briefly the story of Nabi Saleh and the camel that was born as way or by way of miracle. This mu'jiza in itself then served the purpose of being a fitnah, yani a test. Are the people going to obey the sanctity of this camel or no? And the verse of the Quran that stipulates that the camel in itself of Saleh was a fitna. The reference for this, which we did not give yesterday, the reference for this is Surah Al-Qamar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Qamar, verse number 27, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Inna mursilun naqati fitnatan lahum fartaqibhum wastabir. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, indeed, we sent the camel to the community of Nabi Saleh as a fitna. Ya'ni, this mu'jiza was a test. Through the mu'jiza, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would differentiate the believer from the disbeliever. And then we went on to say that this example of a mu'jiza can be used in all meanings of mu'jiza. Miracles of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that happen through the anbiya and through the awliya. This is an example or a place in which a person's iman is tested. Many people mock this idea of mu'jizat, mock these ideas of supernatural events that take place at the hands of the anbiya and the awliya. They try to rationalize them. You find that this in itself is a lack of iman, because this mu'jiza is there to test the iman of a person. This was the ninth meaning. To complete the discussion, the tenth meaning of the word fitna, which is outlined within the Quran, is in Surah Al-A'raf. Surah Al-A'raf, verse number 27. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Ya Bani Adam, لا يفتننكم الشيطان. Ya Bani Adam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, do not let shaitan deceive you. Yani, the deceit of shaitan in this verse of the Quran is categorized as fitna. The job and the function of shaitan al-la'in is what? To beautify the sin, to beautify the dunya, such that a person is tempted, he falls prey to this temptation. This temptation arises from the fact that the sin has been beautified in front of you to such an extent that you feel that you cannot resist, and hence you fall into sin. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya Bani Adam, take care, O man, take care of this deceit of shaitan, this idea of beautifying the sin that looks to be pleasant, that sin that seems to be so tempting. This beautification of the sin, in essence, is a fitna. And the person should have basira. Basira mean he should be farsighted. His iman should be strong enough for him to overcome the zahiri, to overcome this temporary pleasure and be able to see the reality. Which is why within one of the traditions it is mentioned that one of the ashab come to one of the a'imma from Ahlul Bayt. He comes to the imam and he asks him, Yabna Rasulullah, do you ever sin? The imam says, no. He says, how? The imam says to him, would you go, imagine if you were to go to a garbage dump, to paraphrase the hadith, if you were to go to a garbage dump, would you be able to sustain the scent of the garbage? La. And Janabak, as soon as you go to a garbage dump, the first thing happens is you cover your nose because you smell the ugliness, that scent is not concealed from you. Imam Asadiq says, for us a sin is like that. As soon as we see a sin, we can see the ugliness of that sin. On the other hand, if you find a person who lives in a garbage dump, can he differentiate between a bad smell and a good smell? No, because he has become so used to that garbage smell, it doesn't bother him anymore. And similarly, the person who continuously commits sins doesn't see the ugliness of that sin. He doesn't feel the recognize or the need to change from within him. Therefore, the tenth meaning of the word fitna per se is the deceit of shaitan. And from here you find the function of Shahr Ramadan comes in. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says within the Quran, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu kutiba alaykum as-siyam kama kutiba ala ladhina min qablikum la'allakum tattaqun. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says within the Quran, the goal of fasting is to achieve taqwa. And taqwa helps a person refrain from sin. Therefore, what is the understanding of this word taqwa? Taqwa, to a certain extent, to be aware of Allah, to be aware of the consequences of all your actions. We said one meaning of the word fitna is when a person is in a state of mind where he doesn't care about the consequences of his actions. This is what used to give the Bani Israel that audacity to go and kill the Anbiya. Therefore, taqwa, to be aware of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Aware of Allah in that you build a power within you, the power of resistance, which allows you to counter the temptation. Many times a person can't counter temptation because he doesn't have power of resistance. However, Shahru Ramadan, a person builds this power of resistance, this taqa, this determination, this raw potential energy that you have and power that you have inside of you to fight your desires. You discover this hidden power within the month of Shahru Ramadan. Shahru Ramadan, enter Janabak for over 18 hours. You keep away and you abstain from food, and you abstain from water, you abstain from the rest of the muftirat. This requires willpower. This requires determination. This requires a power of resistance. You go against all the medical odds and you deprive yourselves of sleep, and yet you find to a certain extent that in this month you have the highest level of productivity. How does this tawfiq come from? This tawfiq ilahi is an expression of a power that each and every one of us possesses within us. And the idea then is to use this power throughout the rest of the year to continue in the service of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The good habits that a person has collected within Shahr Ramadan, whether it is recitation of Quran or giving of sadaqah or reciting salat on time, or reciting the mustahabbat and the nawafil and salatul layl, or whatever it may be, these habits which a person has gathered in Shahru Ramadan, he should ensure that these habits continue even after Shahru Ramadan. Person who's been reciting one juz of Quran daily, he should try and maintain this habit of one juz even outside of Shahru. And in this way, a person's spirituality is able to continue and continue for the months that are there. Inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you and give each and every one of us tawfiq to benefit from the power of taqwa, inshallah, to continue with the good habits and the good practices that we may have implemented during this month, inshallah.
Allahumma salli ala. So we'll now open the floor for questions. We're going to start off with questions on the topics of from the topics from Sheikh's majalis over the last 10 days.
Assalamu alaikum. Maulana, in one of your majlis, you recited about wasila, and you mentioned ayat number 64 of Surah An-Nisa regarding if you are sinning, then you go to the prophet and ask for the pardon and maghfirat from him, and then Allah also will forgive you. Now, the same question I have relating with this one. I've heard from one of the alim regarding Ya Ali. In our Shia faith, we say Ya Ali as like a wasila of Imam Ali and Ahl-Bayt, you see. So he said that there is no imam or anybody, Rasul said about Ya Ali. Can you give us any explanation about that? And also if you can elaborate about Nadi Alian, give us background of it. Where it came from, Nadi Alian, that Mazhar al-Jaib saying.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أولا In regards to the issue of wasila, the understanding of wasila as per the deen is understood from two ways. Yani, there are two sets or two different types of proof. You have a dalil aam and then you have dalil khas. You have general dalil, general sets of proof that point towards the validity, the legitimacy, rather the importance, even more than that, the obligation of wasila. And then you have, on the other hand, dalil khas. Dalil khas is particular sets of proof when it comes to taking the names of the a'imma. The issue of wasila is very clearly pointed within the Quran, and the scholars from the school of Ahlul Bayt, from the Imamiyya, I think from the beginning of time, from the companions of Amirul Mu'mineen to each and every alim within Ghaybat al-Sughra up till today, Ghaybat al-Kubra, there hasn't been one alim, genuine, legitimate alim from the school of Ahlul Bayt who negates the concept of wasila. Illa, they call him Shadh. Shadh, yani somebody who has gone astray or somebody who is within a minority excluded class. But within the general mainstream thought, this is something which is taught within Ilmul Aqaid at the very basic levels of the Hawza Ilmiya. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clearly says within the Quran, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وابتغوا إليه الوسيلة. This is a command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To who? To those who have iman. If you have iman in Allah, then the way to counter or the way to supplicate to Allah is through wasila. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made a system. This deen was revealed to us through the prophets and through the a'imma. When Allah wanted to communicate with us, did He communicate with us directly? No. Even Allah used the wasila to communicate to you and me. And that wasila was Ahlul Bayt. And that wasila was Anbiya. Then how is it that we go against the sunnah of Allah? No. Allah has decided that this is the way I want to be worshipped. I want to be worshipped through the wasila of Rasulullah and the wasila of Ahlul Bayt. And the proof is there within the Quran. The issue of Ya Ali, this is something very clear. Whenever Rasulullah was in any sort of difficulty, he called upon Imam Ali. In Uhud, when they went out for battle and all the Sahabis, all the Ashab went and abandoned Rasulullah, who did Rasulullah call upon? He said, Ya Ali. In the battle of Hunain, when all again the companions escaped and there was a mutiny, Rasulullah said, Ya Ali. For there is no harm when Rasulullah himself called upon Imam Ali during times of difficulty. And we are told within the Quran that follow in the footsteps of Rasulullah. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنًا. Allah says within the Quran, within the Holy Prophet, there is a good model of example for you. There is a role model for you in the Quran, and he's the best of role models. That is Rasulullah. When Rasulullah was in difficulty, he said, call Ali for me. Even in Khaybar, when Fulan and Fulan went to open the fort, they couldn't. The Muslims were at the brink of defeat. They were about to leave their religions. Rasulullah said, Ya Ali, bring Ali inside to help. Yani, this is what Rasulullah is teaching you. As an ummah, whenever you fall into any difficulty, call upon Imam Ali. There is no difference between Imam Ali in life or death. Again, as per the Quran, وَلَا تَحْسَبَنَّ الَّذِينَ كُتِلُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أَمْوَاتًا بَلْ أَحْيَاءٌ إِنْدَ رَبُّهُمْ إِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ يُرْزَكُونَ. They are alive and they hear. This is dalil am. And then we have dalil khas. We have hadith mu'tabar. Mu'tabar yani a hadith that have the highest level of acceptance, and hadith upon which ulama have done amal, that there are certain a'mal when you are in difficulty, these are a'mal of wasila. There is an a'mal, just now it is not at the top of my head, but it is an a'mal where you do, you will find this, we had mentioned it in the Stanmore Majlis, in the wilada of Sayyida Fatima al-Zahra alayha salam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Where Imam Sadiq alayhi salam teaches us that when you are in difficulty, you go into sajda and 100 times you say, Ya Mawlati, Ya Fatima, Aghithini. And then you put your right cheek on the turba and you say 100 times, Ya Mawlati, Ya Fatima, Aghithini. Our sixth Imam is teaching us when you are in difficulty, go into sajda and say the name of Bibi Fatima. Hadith mu'tabar. No two ulama will dispute over this. Again, we have within the hadith, when you are in difficulty, 100 times you sit with your tasbih and you say, Ya Mawlana Ya Aba Saleh Adrikni. Mawlana Aba Saleh, yani Imam Sahib al-Amri wa Zaman. 100 times you say, Ya Mawlana Ya Sahib al-Zaman Adrikni. Tayyib, why isn't it going and saying, Ya Allah Adrikni? No, the help of Allah comes through the Ahlul Bayt. This is something which is absolutely clear. I think if anyone from the school of Ahlul Bayt tries to object against wasila, it is due to his ignorance.
We have a question from the ladies. With regards to a personal test, example, poor health, how would one know whether this was one of his sins or a test for another reason, especially when one is trying to ascertain one's own position before Allah, as we have many sins which we may not even remember or realize. How can we know whether Allah is pleased with us or not?
In regards to, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, in regards to difficulties, trials and tribulations in the life that we face, whether it is in regards to our health, whether it is in regards to our risk, whether it is in regards to our family, the difficulties that we face, the philosophy of difficulties can have a number of reasons. Number one, it is a form of punishment for previous sins, such that a person, for example, who is afflicted by ill health, this ill health becomes a reason for his atonement, such that when he enters into the qabr or he is raised on the day of judgment, his account is clean with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The suffering due to his illness serves as a punishment for the sins committed. Therefore, he comes yawmul qiyamah, yawmul or in barzakh, and he's free of any sin. He enters into Jannah. This is one. On the other hand, it could be imtihan. Imtihan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is testing this slave, that if I put him through difficulties and difficulties and difficulties, will he implement the concept of sabr? Will he still love me in times of difficulties the way he used to love me in times of good times? Therefore, the difficulties that we have can have a number of reasons. It could either be by way of imtihan, where if he performs sabr and he has tawakkul on Allah, his daraja increases. Or on the other hand, it is atonement for the sins. Sometimes it is very difficult for a person to figure out which the difficulty that is facing, which category is it in. Is it in this category? No, it is in that category. Sometimes it's difficult to ascertain which category it is. But the natija, at the minimum, regardless of whether it is this or regardless of whether it is that, the natija is that a person does not break his connection with Allah. His power of tawakkul does not become weaker. His power of resistance on Allah doesn't reliance. His power of reliance upon Allah does not become weaker, because he knows this difficulty that I am facing in my life is one of two. Either I am getting punished for my previous sins, such that in the akhirah my account will be clean. in which case he says Alhamdulillah, and in another situation he knows that this is a sabr, is an imtihan, and imtihan requires sabr, and the people who have sabr have the highest level of Jannah. The hadith that narrates on the mahshar, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when everybody is raised on the day of judgment, one of the malaika will cry out from within the arsh. They will say, where are those people who are from the sabirin in the dunya? Sabirin, those people who did sabr. Sabr in the face of oppression. Sabr in the face of difficulties. Sabr in that they were happy with little risk that was halal rather than much risk which was haram. They did sabr when people oppressed them. They themselves did not oppress other people, so on so forth. All these things, malaika will call, where are the sabirun? This group of people who used to have sabr in their life will stand up and they will pass through the mahshar, and their accounting is shortened as opposed to other people. So the summary is that regardless of whether this difficulty is from this category or that category, person should keep his heart strong. He should not lose his reliance on Allah and the power of trust and dua. Dua, dua, and dua. So long as a person does dua, he is safe from ibtila. There is greater chance that these ibtila end quickly through the institution of supplication.
Thank you, sir. Any questions from the gents?
Assalamu alaikum. You know the topic question you had before about the wasila. I think I've read somewhere there's some brother al-Sunnah say that they believe on the wasila, but they sometimes say wasila is like the Quran or their good deed. For example, if you're doing lots of good deed in the month of Ramadan, you might say, oh Allah, I'm trying to please you. Can you? So can you just put a bit of light on that? So it's clear that obviously, as you said, that Biyad and Prophet Aimas are actually wasila and not your deed or Quran.
This interpretation can be found in the tafsir of, if I remember correctly, Fakhrur Razi. Fakhrur Razi is from the ulama of the Amma, ulama of the Sunnah, where he says that one of the wasilas, in addition to Ahlul Bayt, for example, is good deeds or is sadaqah. So that if you want a wasila to Allah, you also give sadaqah. Understand, it might qualify as wasila by linguistic meaning of the word wasila in Arabic language, linguistically wasal, to reach to, by means of, maybe it could reach, but what is understood is that these meanings of the Quran were promoted over time to try and bring down the status of Ahlul Bayt. Otherwise, wasila means is through people rather, by actions. If I want my sadaqah to be accepted, do the wasila of Ahlul Bayt. If I want my good deeds to be accepted, I do it through Ahlul Bayt. Which is why they say even when you give sadaqah, recite salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Whenever you want to do any good deed, begin with salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Your dua, you begin with salawat, you end with salawat. So it's very clear that the wasila intended is by group of restricted people. And that is the infallible Ahlul Bayt.
I have a question from the live viewer. In one of Sheikh's majlis, you mentioned that Bani Israel killed 70 prophets in one day. Is this in the Quran or Hadith? Can you please provide details about this incident?
The verse of the Quran that we had referred to in regards to Bani Israel, we have within the Quran that the Bani Israel used to kill the prophets. Generally speaking. Now when we want the details of the Quran, we need to refer back to the hadith. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. He stated in a tradition which is again accepted by all schools of thought, inni tarikun fikum thiqlain kitabullahi wa itrati ahla bayti ma in tamassaktum bihima lan tadhillu ba'di abada. I leave behind for you two weighty things, the Quran and the Ahlul Bayt. So long as you hold on to both of them together, you shall never go astray. Meaning that if you want to understand the Quran, you have to go through Ahlul Bayt. Tafsir of the Quran through Ahlul Bayt. Similarly, if you want to understand the reality and the great Azama and the Daraja of Ahlul Bayt, you cannot understand the reality of the divinity of Ahlul Bayt without the Quran. And this is something that you indicate towards in the A'mal of Laylatul Qadr. In the A'mal of Laylatul Qadr, as you open the Quran in front of you and before you place it on your head, you say, to paraphrase, Allahumma bihaqqi hadhal Quran wa bihaqqi man madahta fi. For example, Ya Allah, I'm asking you by the sake of this Quran, and I'm asking you by the sake of those people who you praise inside the Quran. Ajib. Who is praised inside the Quran? Ahlul Bayt. If you want to understand the position of Amir al-Mu'mineen in the Ummah, look at the Quran. You find, in fact, ulama of ours have compiled books. I have seen ulama, some of them, they have compiled books with over 1,000 verses in the Quran that talk about the fada'il of Amir al-Mu'mineen. 1,000 verses in the Quran. So therefore, just like any detail which a person wants to learn about the Quran, he has to go to hadith of Ahlul Bayt. Quran will tell you over 100 times, wa akimu salat. But within the Quran, you don't find that Salatul Maghrib is 3 times or Isha is 4 rak'ah. Maghrib is 3 rak'ah, Isha is 4 rak'ah. So similarly, when we want details of stories within the Quran, tafsir within the Quran, we have to go back to Ahlul Bayt. There is no option other than Ahlul Bayt. Therefore, we find from within the traditions of Ahlul Bayt that it is mentioned that the Bani Israel would kill sometimes 70 prophets in one day, and that the prophet would come and they would say to them, and tafsir of the Quran speak about this a lot. You can refer to tafsir al-Mizan or tafsir al-Safi, for example, and these incidents are mentioned. 70 prophets would be sent to them in a given day, and they would kill them because the prophet has come with a message that either does not fit with their mentality or that jeopardizes their interests. They would go and they would kill the prophet either by the riverbank, they would come and they would continue their work like as if nothing has happened.
So, I have another question. Sheikh, from one of your madlises, you said that some people are promised Jannat. For example, if a person has lost a baby, that baby will pull them to Jannat. I've heard that a person will be punished for every iota of bad and rewarded for every iota of good that they will do. So can you please explain that point?
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says within the Quran, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ ذَرَّةٍ خَيْرًا يَرَهُ وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِثْقَالَ شَرَّةٍ ذَرَّةٍ شَرًّا يَرَهُ. Person who does an ounce of good deeds, he sees the reward of those good deeds. A person who does an ounce of bad deeds will be done that. This is out of the justice of Allah. However, out of His mercy, if Allah wills not to punish that person, can Allah do this or not? Does He have the power to do this or not? It's Qadir, He can do this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may see that this parent who lost the child has suffered enough in the dunya. Therefore, in the akhirah, his account is clean. And then within this, within the mercy of Allah, you see that there is a system of justice in that whoever had to be rewarded in one way gets his reward, and the one who had to be punished one way or the other has been punished, either in the dunya or before that, alam al-barzakh. A person might have been absolutely sinful, and on the day of judgment, he enters into Jannah by wasilah of Ahlul Bayt. Person turns around and says, oh, but what happened about all the sins that he committed? You and I don't know. Perhaps he paid for those sins in alam al-barzakh. The punishment in barzakh was such that his account has been clean. Not to downplay the punishment of barzakh, but still. And then even yawmul qiyamah, when the shafa'ah of Ahlul Bayt comes, the day of qiyamah is equivalent to 50,000 years. We don't know. You'll get a shafa'ah immediately or after 5 years, after 10 years, after 100 years, after 5,000 years. We don't know. So therefore, the best thing to do is to concentrate on good deeds and have the wasilah of Ahlul Bayt at the same time. But a person should not despair the mercy of Allah.
Excellent. Any questions?
Salam, Sheikh.
Alaykum salam.
Coming to the end of the month of Ramadan, I think it's more of a personal question, but I'll ask it, you know, in front of everyone. For me personally, I find that the month of Ramadan, especially in these, you know, summer months, is very difficult. I struggle. Don't get time to do ibadah. Don't get time to, you know, feel that spirituality. My question really is: is there any signs that we've got that, from any kind of narrations from the prophets or from Ahlul Bayt, that tell us how we can know that, you know, what we've done throughout this month, whether it's a lot or whether it's a little bit, has been accepted, has been, you know, acknowledged? Because this time of the day, I have no energy left. Sure. And, you know, every day is pretty much work, come home, sleep, you know, no time for ibadah. Just, you're just thinking about when you're going to break your fast and eat. And I know, I just feel like, you know, the month goes by and I've not benefited anything from it.
Right. Akhi, you will find that the benefits of Shahru Ramadan are in different forms and different ways. It's not only restricted to ibadat. The fact that you have been experiencing hunger and thirst from almost 2:15, 2:20 in the morning till about 9:45 at night, by you resisting from consuming any food just for the sake of Allah, this in itself speaks about a person's iman. If a person didn't have iman, he would not even care. Jayib, who is stopping you to go and eat? Who is stopping you to go and eat? Nobody's stopping you, even if it is in hiding. Sometimes I feel I will not eat because maybe community will look down upon me. Is there anyone stopping me in hiding? No. That means there is an element of iman within us that is there. Sometimes the test of Shahru Ramadan, even in regards to spirituality, the pain and the difficulty of toiling in the daytime while seeking a rizq which is halal, while being hungry and thirsty, that in itself is the biggest barakat of Shahru Ramadan. That in itself is the biggest barakat of Shahru Ramadan. I think, I don't know if I'd mentioned this over here or in another center, there was a time once, one of the Marajat Taqlid, I think it was Ayatollah Mohsin Al-Hakim, he was traveling from one part of Iraq to another, and he passed through some farmland. And as he was passing through the villages or the farmlands, he stopped by Marjat Taqlid to pray and to greet the people of the village. One of the people from the village came and they gave him a loaf of bread. Loaf of bread, hadiya to the Marjat Taqlid. As a sign of love, this is all he could offer. Ayatollah Mohsin Al-Hakim, one of the greatest maraj of our time, teacher of Sayyid Al-Khoi, rahmatullah alayh. He, the people who are around him, they said, they were witnessing, Ayatollah Mohsin Al-Hakim took this piece of bread, he kissed it, and he put it on his forehead. And then he took a bite of it. People came and they said, Marjat Taqlid, what are you doing? Why did you do this? How? What? Sayyid Al-Hakim said to them, you people don't know the value and the barakah of rizq which is earned in a halal. This struggling and toiling within 30 days just in a state of fasting in itself has got barakah, in itself has got spirituality. And there are certain times this exercise within us, it brings to our attention that there is a power within us, a power of resistance, which previously perhaps we had not discovered. Because you have the power to resist from those things which are halal during the day, this is a proof for you to make you understand and to convince yourself that this same power within you which you can use to refrain from those things which are halal, you can now use them to refrain from those things that are haram. Sometimes within Shahru Ramadan is a time of discovery. Many times a person doesn't, he feels that he's not strong enough in the face of temptation, in the face of sin. He feels that I just don't have that internal power to resist this temptation. Shahr Ramadan is that practical exercise that tells you you have that power within you. You just need to discover it. So even at the very minimum, if a person just recognizes that he has got this power within him, even that in itself is khair and barakat. Another thing that comes to mind in terms of knowing whether our fast is accepted or not, a person should gauge his indulgence to sin. If he feels that he can resist some sins more than he could before Shahr Ramadan, this is an indication that his fasting is kabul. And on top of all this, a person should never lose hope in the mercy of Allah. Allah is the Rahman and Allah is the Rahim. You sit down in your musalla and you contemplate and you speak to Allah and you say, Ya Allah, you know that I have no energy to do dua or to recite Quran during the nights because of the difficulty during the day, but you bless me in my hunger. You bless me in my difficulty. Allah is the Rahman. Allah is the Rahim. And the person should not lose hope or feel that I don't know if my fasting is accepted or not. Allah. During the time of Salatul Maghrib, every day at the time of Maghrib, Hadith Sharif says, Allah releases over millions and millions of people from Nar Jahannam. Spirituality is about doing something small, but with the right heart. This dua that you recite at the time of Iftar, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Allahumma laka sumtu, wa ala rizqika aftartu, wa alayka tawakkalt. Three sentences that takes you 20 seconds. If you recite this with a true heart, knowing what it means, Allah releases you from Nar Jahannam. You get the thawab of the people who have fasted in the dunya that day. How many people have fasted today? 1 billion people have fasted. Because you recited these three sentences, Allah gave you the thawab of 1 billion people fasting. This is spirituality. Just you took that 20 seconds to recite the dua from the bottom of your heart. Ya Allah, this hunger, this thirst was for you. Ya Allah, I'm going to break this fast on this rizq which you have given me. Ya Allah, everything in my life I trust on you. Something as simple. Many times we think that spirituality and iman and taqwa is attained by performing complicated things in life. La. Iman and taqwa and spirituality is performed or is gained from performing the most simple things in life. Person who can't recite Quran, 3 times Suratul Ikhlas, you get the thawab of an entire Quran. Spirituality is attained through the basic actions, but the actions done rightly. I know there are some people who struggle to even recite the entire dua iftitah in one night. So what they do is, they say that from dua iftitah every night, we'll recite only 2 lines. But we'll recite these 2 lines and contemplate over them. We'll think over them. We'll research over them. That is much better than just mechanical parrot type reading. Not to say that dua iftitah should stop in the mosque. No, recitation of the dua as a dua is important. And it happens in a center. But in our own time, to recite 1 or 2 lines with quality is better than wholesale quantity, which then has no effect on the soul.
A question from the ladies. In regards to what you said about being ill and how your sins are forgiven, is there any reason for sudden death?
Is there any reason for?
Sudden death.
For sudden death. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, number one, says in regards to death, everybody's time is appointed. Everybody has got a set time. We don't know our time, whether it is by way of car accident or whether it is death in sleep or death by drowning or the people of Baghdad. See the bomb blast that happened? 27th of Shahru Ramadan. What do you and I know? But 23rd of Shahru Ramadan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destined Laylatul Qadr. Movie said this is when everybody's lifetime is decided. Allah decided on 23rd that these people's lives will end. And ulama have come forward with statements that these are shuhada in Jannah with Amirul Mu'mineen and with Sayyid al-Shuhada and with Ahlul Bayt. It was written for them in their taqdeer this year that you will meet Ahlul Bayt in Jannah. For death is appointed. You and I cannot stop. A person can be sick. There are those people who have challenged terminal illnesses for years. They cheated all the doctors and they cheated the disease and they recovered for a long life. And then there are those people who took care of their diets and they took care of their food and they didn't eat carbs and they didn't eat na ghee, no nothing. And one day, heart attack, he didn't wake up. Dunya is like this. Allah is the one who has decided that there is a given time. Everybody has been allocated a certain amount in their life. This one 50 years, this one 70 years, this one 90 years, this one 100 years. That is set by Allah. Yes, there are certain things that we can do in our life to prolong our lifetimes. Like for example, charity. It is narrated that a person who gives sadaqah protects himself, particularly from sudden death. Yes. So there are certain good acts that we can do that can change the taqdeer, that can change predestiny. But in essence, the rule of thumb is that all of this is set and decided by Allah. Our bigger concern should be that we have accumulated enough good deeds before our time comes.
Any question from the gents? Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum salam.
Mawlana, you recited in one of your majalis regarding Amr ibn Ma'ruf. Now, on a daily basis, we see things that are not right in front of us, sometimes within friendship groups, sometimes within families, sometimes within the mosque. Do we, Islamically, do we have to raise our voice at everything? Is Allah, obviously, we will be asked on the Day of Judgment for every small little things. But if the situation in front of you is such that if you raise your voice or you say something, it might cause discomfort or harm to the person in front of you or to whoever's group or whatever, then where do we stand? Do we have to raise our voice at every Amr bil Ma'ruf or?
Sure. In regards to understanding Amr bil Ma'ruf, understanding Nahi Anil Munkar is also very important. Just like the way it is from the wajibat, it is one of the furu'd deen, and Amr bil Ma'ruf is wajib, whether somebody likes it or somebody doesn't like it. Nahi Anil Munkar is wajib, whether somebody likes it or doesn't like it. Just like the way salat is wajib, whether a person likes it or doesn't like it, doesn't matter, salat is wajib. Whether a person likes it or doesn't like it, khums is wajib. Whether a person likes it or doesn't like it, zakat is wajib. Whether a person likes it or doesn't like it, hajj is wajib. Sahih? Same way, Amr bil Ma'ruf and Nahi anil Munkar are also wajib. But just like the way salat has conditions, sawm has conditions, hajj has conditions, similarly, Amr bil Ma'ruf and Nahi anil Munkar also have conditions. How to do Amr bil Ma'ruf in the right way? How to do Nahi anil Munkar in the right way? There are times when it is wajib, there are times when it is not wajib. The manner in which you decide to do Amr bil Ma'ruf depends on the issue that is on hand. The severity of the issue has a different measure. If an issue is not that serious, it has a different style of approach. For every issue, there is a particular style. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, فَدْعُوا إِلَىٰ سَبِيلِ رَبِّكَ بِالْحِكْمَةِ وَالْمَوْئِذَةِ الْحَسَنَةِ. Invite towards the path of your Lord with hikmah and with akhlaq, with good behavior. I need to see, okay, there is something wrong that is happening in the mosque. I want to change it. How can I change it? Sometimes I think, okay, if I take a confrontational approach, what's going to happen is, many of the times when an issue is being trying to solve, if my initial response is confrontational, then naturally speaking, the guy who is on the other hand is going to feel attacked, goes on the defensive, and now it becomes a confrontation where each person wants to try and safeguard on his ego. Many times it's like that. So I have to think, okay, I need to think of a gentle way. I need to think of a smart way to bring up the Amr bil Ma'ruf in a friendly manner, where sometimes maybe I can sugarcoat the message. You see, the best example of Amr bil Ma'ruf that was given, a person needs to think how Amr bil Ma'ruf can be done, which is the most effective way for the good deed to be taken. And you see this example of hikmah, this is which is very famously narrated. One time, Imam Hassan and Imam Hussein, they were children. They saw an old person doing wudu in an incorrect way. They said, now how do we tell this person? He said, we are children, 5-6 years old. We cannot go to, for example, 70-80-year-old man and tell him, oh, Mze, the way you're doing wudu is wrong, or make fun of him or anything like that. But at the same time, Amr bil Ma'ruf is necessary. This is your wudu. If your wudu is not correct, your entire salah is not correct. And if your salah is not correct, there is ishkal on the validity of your actions. As-salat amududdin. In kubilat kubilat ma siwaha wa in ruddat ruddat ma siwaha. If salat is accepted, everything is accepted. If salat is not accepted, mushkil. So Imam Hassan and Imam Hussein said, what do we do? We find the strategy they use for Amr bil Ma'ruf. They didn't tell that old man, Umze, you are wudu is wrong. What did they say? They went to the Umze and they said to him, obviously they didn't say to him, Umze, but in Arabic, they said to him, oh man, oh uncle, or whatever it is, you see which one of us is doing correct wudu. So Imam Hassan did wudu the wrong way, in which the old man used to do, while Imam Hussein did wudu in the correct way. And then they both went to the old person and they said, you judge. And the old man realized, this is the correct way to do wudu. See, Amr bil Ma'ruf, where the message was delivered, change was implemented, and nobody felt bad. So, person sometimes need to think, in a way, how to go forward, inshallah.
Excellent. We'll close there on the last question as Salat time is approaching. I'd like to thank Sheikh for tonight's question and answer session. Also, on behalf of the President and the Management Committee, I would like to thank Sheikh for his stay here, for his lectures and majalis over the last 10 nights. And we pray to Allah to give us tawfiq to act upon what we have heard over the last 10 nights. And inshallah, we get the opportunity to host Sheikh again in the future. I'd like to recite Surah Fatiha for all our Marhumin al-Fatiha. توجه زيارات بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله السلام عليك يا ابن رسول الله السلام عليك يا ابن أمير المؤمنين وابن سيد الوصيين السلام عليك يا ابن فاطمة الزهراء سيد سائر العالمين السلام على الحسين وعلى علي ابن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين خصوصا سيدي ومولاي أبو الفضل العباس ابن أمير المؤمنين وأختك زينب وبنتك سكينة جميعا ورحمة الله وبركات السلام عليك يا غريب الغرباء السلطان أبا الحسن علي بن موسى الرزاء ورحمة الله وبركات السلام عليك يا مولانا يا صاحب الأصل والزمان الأمان 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 من فتنة الزمان السلام عليك يا خليفة الرحمن السلام عليك يا شريك القرآن السلام عليك يا إمام الإنس والجان أجل الله تعالى فرجك وسهل الله تعالى مخرجك وزهورك السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم اللهم كل وليك الحجة ابن الحسن صلواتك عليه وعلى آبائه في هذه الساعة وفي كل ساعة وليا وحافظا وقائدا وناصرا ودليلا وعينا حتى تسكنه أرضك طوعا وتمتعه فيها طويلا اللهم صل على محمد والفاتح
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الله ملائكة يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما صل على محمد وعلى محمد سبحان الله والحمد لله ولا إله إلا الله الله أكبر ولله الحمد الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله اللهم صل على محمد أشهد أن محمد رسول الله اللهم أشهد أن أمير المؤمنين وإمام المتقين علي ولي الله أشهد أن أمير المؤمنين وإمام المتقين علي حجة الله حي على السلام حي على السلام حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح حي على خير العمل حي على خير العمل الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله لا إله إلا الله اللهم صل على محمد